بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. الصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك، فاعف عنهم واستغفر لهم وشاورهم في الأمر، فإذا عزمت فتوكل على الله إن الله يحب المتوكلين. صدق الله العظيم. Brothers and elders in Islam, before I start off with the talk, I would give you 3 seconds. You can close your eyes and you think about your role model, whom you prefer to follow in life. So for 3 seconds, think who is your role model in life. Fine. How many of us thought about our parents? Anybody? I have taken my father to be my role model. MashaAllah, there is one. How many of you have taken the role models as Sahaba? MashaAllah. How many genuinely speak? Okay. Has taken the role model as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah give us the tawfiq to follow his footsteps, inshaAllah. Fine. So before we start off, there is something called you listen to a lecture and you hear a lecture. Most of the time, what people do is we hear a lecture, we don't listen. When you take the Jummah sermon, thousands of Muslims gather every week. But once the sermon is over, half an hour time or 45 minutes, when you ask the same person who was seated there with great difficulty, you ask him, what did you hear? He would say, yeah, the bayan was fine, it was interesting, it was mashallah, you know, it was energizing my iman. So what did you listen? He would say, you know, he spoke about something which was really interesting. He's unable to express his thoughts by words. Sometimes we also fall into that category. So what we have to do is, brothers, we have to listen to a lecture but not hear. The difference between hear and listen, maybe most of us will know it. Moment I'm speaking, you can hear the fans are working. Right? This you call it hear. And what you're listening to me while I speak, it is what you call as listen. So attention is very important when it comes to listening to any lecture. And number two, mashallah, when we take the times of today, Islam has become accessible compared to the past. When we sit with our parents, our grandparents, and we ask them, did they have such programs every Thursday or every Poya day or mahal, like a program in the masjid, local masjid? If we ask them, they would say 50, 60 years back we didn't have any programs such as this. But today, it is time that we are accessible to the extent, if we have a mobile phone, we can log online, we can Google, choose the sheikh we want, we can listen to him as long as we want. So Islamic material has become so accessible today, it is in our fingertips. But the question which each one of us have to pose to our own self is, what change has this material brought in my life? If this material cannot bring a change in my life, it means we are at risk. We need to renew, we need to refresh our intentions before listening to any talk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, verily, the hearing, the sight you see, the eyesight, and your thinking power, your thought, is going to be questioned on the day of Qiyam, including myself. All of us, we have to answer to this question to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day. Allah is going to ask us, you listen to this talk on this topic, what did you bring it in, what practice was made by you after this talk? Allah should protect each one of us. If this talk becomes a witness against us, it will be a sabab, a reason for regret and remorse. So before we listen to a lecture, each one of us, including myself, I should renew my intention, correct my intention, that I am speaking to myself, and those listeners here should have the intention, at least I am going to practice according at least one of the teachings which I am going to learn today, at the minimum. If not, we are at risk. And also, brothers and elders in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us 2 ears and a mouth. What could be the reason? You listen more and you speak less. When you look into the life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to speak very less. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to speak very less. But they used to frequent the majlis of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to listen to more things. So after they listened, what impact did it have in their life? They used to bring it into practice. It is the same thing what we have to do in our lives as well. The other day I was talking to one of the brothers. He was telling me, Sheikh, today lectures have spread to such an extent that everybody knows that a particular lecture takes place in a masjid, in an institute, in different places. But the problem is, he says, some of the hearts of today have become bayan-proof. We had waterproof wristwatches, we had so many things which are waterproof, mobile phones waterproof, and now hearts of humans have become bayan-proof. They listen to Friday lectures, they listen to weekly lectures, they listen to monthly lectures, but end of the day when you look at the percentage of the change in the community, it is very, very less, and we are heading towards some other direction. So we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the correct understanding and to make us practice whatever we learn. When it comes to listening, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about listening in many places in the Quran. But I would like to briefly highlight on 3 ayahs. In one of the ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ ذَرَعْنَا لِجَهَنَّمَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنِّ. Surely we have created a lot of people from the jinn and the mankind who will be destined to the Jahannam. Who are destined to the Jahannam. لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا. Thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the qualities of these people. He says, لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ. They have hearts, but they do not understand. وَلَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ أَعْيُنٌ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ بِهَا. They have got eyes, but they don't see with their eyes. Afterwards Allah says, وَلَهُمْ آذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا. They have ears, but they do not hear. أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ. They are like cattle, rather they are much more worse than that. So why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention these 3? The heart, the sight, and the hearing. What has to be noted here is, brother, these are the 3 ways in which a person will understand and able to differentiate between the good and the bad. If a person listens to good, he would start thinking about good. The moment he starts to think about good things, he would only look at what is good. So there is a relationship between each of these. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in this verse that if any person, whoever misuses these 3 senses, he is going to be in Jahannam, and he is far worse than the cattle and animals. Allah protect all of us. In another verse in the Holy Quran, Allah says, which most of us are very familiar with, وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلُ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيدِ. In Surah Al-Mulk, Allah says, on the day of judgment, when the people will be about to enter Jahannam, they are in the entrance of Jahannam, and at that moment, they will be regretting. Why do I need to enter this Jahannam? It is because of my actions. Now he starts to regret about his actions. And what he says, وَقَالُوا لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعْ أَوْ نَعْقِلْ. In the worldly life, if we were to listen to good, and if we were to think and understand about good things, مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ, we would have not ended up here. this ayah highlights to us that a turning point in a person's life is the moment he starts to hear good things. For an example, when we take a young boy, when he has his group in his school or in his locality, wherever, we see that boy was brought up in a very decent family with good etiquette, with good morals, with good conduct. But all of a sudden we see that boy is going astray from the correct track. Why is it? The reason is, brothers, when he started to intermingle with his group, he started to listen to that which is haram, that which is not permitted. Automatically his heart started to contaminate and it started to rust because of this evil. And by that, when his heart became rusted with evil, his actions turned into bad deeds. So the moment a person's deeds start changing into bad deeds, obviously all of us know that person will be destined to Jahannam. That is the regret which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mulk. But with regard to those people who listen to good things, who listen to Allah's word, Nabi's life, and who practice according to that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about them in His Holy Quran. He says, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنًا. Those who listen to what is said, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ, those who listen to what is being said, فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنًا, and they follow the best of it. So after you listen to a lecture, you follow the best of what was spoken. Allah says regarding these people, أُولَٰئِكَ هَدَاهُمُ اللَّهُ, those are the ones whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided. These are the people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, and they are the ones who possess the correct understanding. So may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst that group who would listen to good and follow what is good, and make us amongst those who possess the correct understanding. So coming to the topic for today, brothers, when we take Islam, Islam is a comprehensive religion which has taught us all sorts of teachings which is related to a human being's day-to-day life. Whereas when we take any other religion, we would see their teachings are restricted to their worship places, maybe inside a particular place where they spend their time worshipping. So apart from that, the moment they leave that place, the religion doesn't teach them or guide them in any way. So they are stranded and they only follow their teachings inside the worship places. But whereas when you take Islam, Islam is so massive and it is so explanative. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained each and every aspect of a human being's life. Whether you're inside the masjid, whether you're in the bazaar, whether you're in the masjid, whether you're in the whether you're working at your office, whether you're at the market, Islam has taught us many teachings which we can derive and which will become a means for our correct guidance in this world as well as the hereafter. So for this, to teach this Islam to us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a human being. He sent a human being. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent an angel to teach the people of how to conduct themselves in this life, we will have a very nice excuse. We will say, he's an angel, how can a human being follow an angel? Yes or no? That would be the case. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a human being. He sent a human being who has the needs which an average person will have. He will undergo hunger, he will have to quench his thirst, he will have to fulfill his desires, he will have to work, he will have to earn something. These are the basic needs of a human being. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a human being with all these needs so that he can be the best example which the person who is going to come down the line, the day before Qiyamah, even he could follow him. He was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and elders in Islam, all of us know that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was free from sin and he was free from all defects and all faults. I will come to a couplet when a sahabi starts to describe Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you would understand Arabic, you would really appreciate its meaning. When he takes Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he played different roles in his life. Now, if I were to ask one of you, what role do you play? You could mention maximum around 10 to 15. I am a son, I am a brother, I am a brother-in-law, a few. We have, some of us even not have not started our career in working. We are not even working under somebody. We are still studying. So we are still in our initial stages of life. But when you take Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has played the roles in his life to the extent he has covered everything. There was a time he was a very rich man. There was a time he was a spiritual mentor. He was a leader. He was a teacher. He was a student. He was a father. He was a husband. He was a grandfather. He was a husband. He was a warrior. So many roles played by one person. By one person. And we see not a single place has history ever pointed fingers at Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that he hasn't performed one of these things in the correct manner. Nowhere in history will find it. Because Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam excelled in all roles whatever he played. He didn't leave any space for anybody to point fingers at. So when it comes to his physical features, we could classify into two: physical features and his morals and character. He was a handsome man whom the Sahaba used to say, I have not seen a handsome person than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, maybe they are very familiar with this Sahabi, he said he accepted Islam when he was 60 years old and he passed away when he was 120. So he was a Muslim for 60 years. So he was a very famous poet in Arabia at that time. He composes a poem. He says, وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَقَتُ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلَ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّعًا مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. He says, أَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَقَتُ عَيْنِي. My eye has never seen a more handsome person than you. وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْ كَلَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ. Not a single lady would have given birth to a handsome child, a beautiful child than you. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّعًا مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ. O my Nabi, you have been created free from all sorts of defects and faults. كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. When we look into you, it is as if you have been created the way you wish for it. Allahu Akbar. Look at the description of the Sahabi regarding Nabi's beauty. And when it comes to his character too, when it comes to his character, in Arabic, they say, there's a phrase which says, وَالْحَقُّ مَا شَهِدَتْ بِهِ الْأَعْدَاءُ. The truth is that which the enemies of yours should also acknowledge. When it comes to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we see Abu Sufyan, he accepted Islam in the 8th year of Hijrah, just approximately 3 years before the death of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This Abu Sufyan, he was called to one of the kings who lived at the time of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, called Abu Sufyan and asked him about the description of Nabi and about the character of Nabi. Abu Sufyan was a person who was dead against Islam. He hated Islam. He didn't want Islam to spread in Makkah, and he did all sorts of efforts for that. And this kafir is called to the court of a king. And the king questions him about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How is his character? Is he a loyal person? Is he a trustworthy man? Does he fulfill his promise? All these questions are posed to Abu Sufyan, and Abu Sufyan has to reply about the Prophet. So you see, Abu Sufyan, before his Islam, he was an enemy of Prophet. But this king was very smart. He asked Abu Sufyan to sit in front, and he asked the companions of Abu Sufyan to sit behind him. Because if Abu Sufyan is lying, those seated behind will make gestures saying that he is lying. So Abu Sufyan was forced to speak the truth. So the moment the king starts to ask this question from a bitter enemy of Islam, he acknowledges, he says, he is a very loyal person, he fulfills the promise, he's a very kind man, and he starts to acknowledge the qualities of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Arabic they say, وَالْحَقُّ مَا شَهِدَتْ بِهِ الْأَعْدَاءُ. The truth is that which your enemies also confess or acknowledge. So we see the enemies of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they too acknowledge that he was a very nice man. He was a genuine person. He was an upright man. When we take our time of today, what do people speak about? What do they tell about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Encyclopedia of Britannica, you will see, when you read under Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is mentioned, Muhammad is the most successful of all prophets and religious personalities. This is not mentioned by the Muslims, brothers. This is not mentioned by the Muslims. It is mentioned by the non-Muslims. And the famous book, The 100 Most Influential People in History, written by Michael H. Hart, he says he wasn't a Muslim. You can understand it by his name. He ranks Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as number one. After he does it, he says, my choice of Muhammad to lead the list of the world's most influential persons may surprise some readers. May surprise some readers. Why did you rank Muhammad number one? And may be questioned by others. They could pose a question, why did you choose him to be number one? And he says, the reason for that is, he was the only man in history. He was the only man in history who was supremely successful in both religious and secular levels. Allahu Akbar. In both religious and secular levels, there wasn't anybody on the face of this earth. There isn't anybody who can come to this face of this earth and will never come like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who can perform his best when it comes to his religious affairs and also his secular level. So brothers and elders in Islam, let us take Isa alayhi salatu wa salam. Why did he rank him as number one? It is a very easy answer. Isa alayhi salam didn't play a role as a father. He wasn't a husband, nor was he a grandfather, but he was a prophet. But Isa alayhi salam didn't play this part in his life. He wasn't a father, nor a grandfather, or nor was he a... He didn't have children. So he didn't get married. So we see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had even fulfilled that. He has played that role as well, and he has mastered that as well. So brothers and elders in Islam, it is very important that we increase our knowledge with regard to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is the nature of human beings that if we love somebody, it is our nature that we want to study more about him. We want to learn more about him. That is our nature. But when it comes to, so for an example, a sportsman. I know a very young kid. He was around 10 years when the World Cup took place. Not the recent one. The previous World Cup, the Cricket World Cup. So the moment our country lost the final, he was around 9. We never thought that the game had such an impact in this young boy's life. All of a sudden he wakes up in the middle of the night and he starts to cry. So his mother goes to him and she says, like, what makes you cry? What is the reason you're crying? He said, no, so many days I was watching the World Cup. I expected Sri Lanka to come to the final. But the moment I see them lose, I cannot bear it anymore. No, I still remember the so-and-so, he was getting out, he was out and the crowds were upset, and I was taken up by the game, and now I cannot control myself. That is why I am crying. So this boy who was sleeping, he woke up due to the cricket match, because the country has lost, and he started to cry. Why is this? Because he has the muhabbat towards that game. Likewise, brothers and elders in Islam, we know so many instances that people have suicided themselves when their most beloved has left them or he has left his world. Sometimes this happens in the community. MashaAllah, when it comes to the Muslims, it is very less, but that is what love can do to a human being. But let us take the knowledge we have regarding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's very important. When you speak about the Prophet, we generally think that Prophet was a very kind man, a very simple man. He wasn't a very brave person. He used to be in the receiving end, but he wasn't a person who used to deliver. This is what we think about Nabi. But respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we read the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will come across so many instances. End of the lecture, inshallah, I will encourage you to read a few books. In those books it is mentioned regarding his bravery, regarding his kindness, regarding his generosity, regarding the way he interacted with poor people, the way he interacted with the rich. So many things are discussed in those books. So brothers and elders in Islam, one of the shaykhs, he mentions this story in his lecture. I would like to share it with you. This incident happens in Saudi Arabia. So the Sheikh Arifi, a very famous sheikh, he has over 8 million likes in his Facebook. So the Sheikh says, he went to his students who were studying at the secondary level, secondary school. He goes to them and he says, could you name the wives of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So the students there, they say, Sheikh, don't ask us this easy question. We are 16 or 17 and 18. And you're asking us this easy question about Nabi. We are Arabs. Nabi was from us. We are Arabs. So you're asking us this simple question. But the Sheikh, he insisted, it's all right. Just tell me the name. So in the class, there were around 40 students. So one of them raises the hand and he says, Sheikh, Khadija. Other Sheikh says, MashaAllah, good. Another student, he raises his hand, he says, Aisha. Says, fine. And all of a sudden, nobody raises their hand. He was shocked. He said, anybody here? There are 11 wives. Could you mention a few more? You just mentioned two. There are 9 remaining. He said, we can't exactly remember. Then the Sheikh said, okay, I will help you out. You will have to fill in the blank and I'm going to tell you the letters. So if it is Sauda, he used to say, Seen, Wow, Dal, Blank, Hamza. Say, ah, Sauda, Sauda, Sauda. And he started to make things easy for the students. The moment, and finally, they started to fill in the blanks and they completed the 11 names. The Sheikh says, when Denmark started to draw cartoons or depicting and putting the image of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam very low, you were emotion. The whole Muslim world was screaming and shouting and protesting against the person who drew the cartoons. At the same time, you people don't know about your own prophet. Most of the time, brothers, we lack knowledge regarding our prophet. Sometimes when we compare ourselves with the non-Muslims as well. Great leaders like Mahatma Gandhi, he too has mentioned about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has read the biography of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He mentions that. How many of us have read his biography? The man who was free from all defects. A man whom, if we have to follow him, we are rewarded. How far do we have knowledge about him? So this Sheikh, he said, okay, let me leave that question aside. Now I'm going to ask you a very easy question. He said, most of us know that the Arabs are very fond of football. So he said, give me the name of the football players in the Brazilian team. So the boy says, Sheikh, I know it, I know it. You know, the whole class started to raise their hands up. So he said, okay, wait, one at a time. He said, Kaka, Tutu, you know, all these names started to come from nowhere. The Sheikh says, I don't know the names of the players, but he mispronounced the person's name. One of the students said, Sheikh, you don't know his name. And he started to correct the Sheikh, saying, he's not Kaka, he's so and so. Don't you know this famous player? The Sheikh says, you bother about me not knowing the name of a sportsman, but whereas you are negligent, you are unaware of the wives of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Brothers and elders in Islam, most of the time, when we take our personal levels, like we are lacking this knowledge about his seerah. So it is very important that we read, we study his seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, let us go to the next point. It is regarding following the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions many verses in the Holy Quran regarding following his messenger. One of the verses Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Indeed, in the Messenger of Allah, you have a good example. Indeed, in the Messenger of Allah, you have a good example to follow. Who is going to follow him? The one who hopes to meet Allah and the one who remembers Allah much. The one who remembers Allah and the one who knows that I'm going to meet my Allah one day, the one who fears these two things, one who expects these two things to happen, He is a person who is going to follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another verse in the Holy Quran, Allah says, مَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهُ. One who obeys the Messenger has verily obeyed Allah. And in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تُطِعُوهُ تَهْتَدُوا. If you obey the Messenger, you will be guided in the correct path. When we take the companions of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when it comes to following his footsteps, Anas radiallahu anhu, he was a very young sahabi, he said, I used to serve alcohol to my friends. You know, I had a group of people. We used to gather in the house of Abu Talha, and I used to serve alcohol to those who would visit the place. And one day, Abu Talha, the owner of the house, he was inside, and while I was serving the alcohol to the people, all of a sudden he tells me, why don't you go out, I hear somebody making an announcement. So Anas radiallahu anhu says, I left the alcohol and the wine aside and I went out to listen what the announcement was about. He says, the moment I went out, I heard the announcement was regarding alcohol, that it has been made haram. So he comes running to the house and he says, Abu Talha, the announcement which was made is regarding alcohol, and the verses have been revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying it is not permitted for us to consume it anymore. The moment Abu Talha radiallahu anhu hears this, he says, just throw away all the alcohol, all the wine, whatever is inside this house. This is mentioned in other riwayat, there were people who had those utensils with alcohol just about to put it in their mouth. The moment they heard this verse to be revealed, immediately they threw the whole thing off. Allahu Akbar. We see at that time nobody came forward to ask the question, is it wajib? Is it sunnah to leave it? Is it mustahab? Is it makruh? Maybe in our sense, sometimes when a shaykh mentions it is haram to do it, somebody tries to make it at least the level of makruh. So that if we do it, you are not punished, and if you don't do it, you are rewarded. But Sahaba, the moment they heard the verse had been revealed, they said it's haram, khalas, we don't want anything else. Sunnah, mustahab, wajib, makruh, we don't care, it is haram, khalas, that's it. That was the iman they had. But subhanallah, today when we take our time, each one of us should think about our own self. The amount of people who follow the footsteps of Nabi, is it increasing day by day or is it decreasing day by day? How many of us would sleep, would have our meals, will have some water, will travel, will interact with our friends in the manner in which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it? How many of us would perform wudu prior to sleep? How many of us would say Bismillah just before we take a morsel of food? Day by day, the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is decreasing and it is becoming extinct. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man ahya sunnati, the one who revives my sunnah, the one who practices my sunnah and brings it back, faqad ahabbani, he has loved me. He has loved me. وَمَنْ أَحَبَّنِي كَانَ مَعِي فِي الْجَنَّةِ. And the one who loves me is going to be with me in Jannah. So if we follow the footsteps of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are going to be in the companionship of his in the day of judgment and as well as in Jannah. May Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that. So brothers and elders in Islam, when it comes to following the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have to be precautious as well regarding, we shouldn't go to the extremes. We shouldn't go beyond the level and start innovating new things. For an example, three Sahaba at the time of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to meet Ummahatul Mu'mineen. So when they went to meet them, they asked about the ibadah of Nabi, about the nights of Nabi, about the fasting of Nabi. So the moment they heard, all of them, the three of them decided on three extremes. So one of them said, I am not going to sleep in my life, I am going to stay awake, I am going to spend my night in Salah. The second person, he said, I am going to observe Salah every day and I am not going to break, I am going to follow the sunnah of Dawud alayhi salam. So every day, I beg your pardon, I am going to fast every day So there won't be a day in my life that I have spent without fasting. The third one said, I am going to abstain from women and I will never marry. So Rabbi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed about this. He was informed about these three extremes. So he called the three Sahaba, his companions, and he said to them, I am the most God-fearing, I am the most Allah-fearing person, more than you. Ana atqana. You fear Allah, but I fear Allah more than you. But even though that is the case, I fast and I break my fast, I sleep and I stay awake at night, I marry and I consummate my marriage, I do so many things, what made you people do this? And after that he said, فَمَنْ رَقِبَ عَنْ سُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. The one who turns away from my sunnah is not from me. So we see, when we follow the footsteps of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is important that we don't go in extremes. But today in our times, we see many youngsters have different role models. We have got trend setters and trend followers. When you take a school, for an example, a very young child who is studying at grade 1 or 2, the moment you take him to a shop to buy a toy or something which he fancies, he expects to buy some brand or some certain type of a toy. He says, I want that toy. If you ask him, why do you want that toy? He would say, because my friend has it. Because my friend has it. Likewise, if you take a young boy like us, most of us here, if you ask, are you going to buy a new phone? He would say, yes. So, you're interested in Apple, Samsung, what? He would say, no, I would like to go for the latest S5. Why is it? No, all my friends in class have it. So, do you want to buy the phone for your need, or do you want to follow those who are along with you, your peers? It is natural that a human being will fall prey to his peers. He will start following them. And when they grow up, it doesn't leave. It is still in us. It will be in a different form. We'll be driving a car, and all of a sudden we see our neighbor is parking his car, which is a BMW, and you start dreaming, when am I going to park the same car in front of my gate? When you grow older, we have different needs. And likewise, we start thinking of different things. We start to compare ourselves with others. The moment we do that, respect to brothers and elders in Islam, we lose track, and at times we might even fall into haram. When we take some youth of today, we see some of their hairstyles, it is as if they have been like electrified. They have got a current shock and everything is standing straight. You know? The hair, strands of hair, all straight. And all of a sudden you see another boy, he's wearing something really weird and he says, no, I saw so and so wear it in such such film and I fancy that and I enjoy it. So different youth of today have got different role models. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks regarding these role models in the Holy Quran. He says, Istabarra alladhina tubi'u min alladhina taba'u wara'a al-'adhab wa taqatta'at bihim al-asbab. On the day of Qiyamah, when those who followed will disown their followers. Today somebody is following a sportsman, an actress, or actor, or celebrity. These people on the day of Qiyamah will come and they will say, Ya Allah, I am disowning these followers. I never asked them to follow me. And they will be, the moment they see the punishment, the moment they see Jahannam, the bond they used to have will be disconnected. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says afterwards, the moment the trend setter would tell this to the trend follower will say, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا قَرَّةً. They would say, we wish if we had a chance to return to the world so that we may disown them as they have disowned us. We never expected these people to do this to us. We followed them. And when they come to Qiyamah, they're saying that we disowned them. We didn't ask them to follow. So if we have the opportunity of going back to the dunya again, we will do the same thing to them. We will not follow them. Thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلِكَ يُرِيهِمُ اللَّهُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ حَسَرَاتٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show them their deeds to be nothing. They would start regretting. The word hasarat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't use the word hasratun. Allah used the word hasarat. Regret after regret. Regret after regret. those people will be regretting continuously. After they enter Jahannam, they will be regretting. Before entering Jahannam, they are regretting. So brothers and elders in Islam, it is very important we take the correct role model as follower so that he can help us on that day. Now let us see, I would like to mention four instances of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam which really caught my eye. When it comes to his akhlaq, that was what I wanted to highlight today, basically. All of us know there is a famous saying, the first impression is the last impression. All of us are familiar with this. So always, the first impression is imprinted in your mind. The moment we see a person for the first time, that is the impression which is going to be there forever. In Egypt, in the rural area, they had a habit of showing their strength, their valor, and their colors to their wives. So what did they do? In the rural parts of Egypt, in the ancient Egypt, in the rural areas, on the wedding night, this bridegroom, what he does, he takes a cat and he ties it inside his room. The moment he enters the room and he's alone with his wife, he does something to set the cat free without his wife knowing it. So the moment the cat starts to meow, the wife, like, she gets tense. This man knows that there's a cat and he jumps and he says, okay, you don't worry, I'm going to help you and I will see to it. And he shows he jumps at the cat and he beats the cat and the poor cat is killed. So the moment the wife sees this incident, she feels, mashallah, he's a very courageous man, he's very brave. You know, all of a sudden from nowhere a cat comes and he jumps and he kills the cat. So the first impression which was imprinted in her mind cannot be erased forever. So this is one of the methods they used to have in Egypt, the rural area. But always we have to keep it in mind that the akhlaq is what imprints in others' mind. Your looks doesn't matter. A person's looks doesn't matter much. But what matters is the akhlaq you have. The good qualities you have is what matters. That is what an Arab poet he said, Ya khadim al jismi kam tasqa bi khidmatin atatlubu ar-ribha mimma fi ma fihi khusranu. He says, oh, the one who adorns himself. Each one of us, if we are to stand in front of the mirror, we take some time. Yes. So we see, like, when we are preparing ourselves, we are getting ready for a wedding, we take a long time. And when we are preparing ourselves to go for a lecture, we take some time. We go going to the masjid, sometimes we don't care what we wear. So we adorn ourselves to the maximum level best to beautify ourselves. So he says, Ya khadim al jismi kam tasqa bi khidmatihi. You underwent so much of trouble and difficulty just to look attractive. Atatlubu ar-ribha mimma fihi khusranu. Do you want to seek some gain in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept lost? So what he means here is, brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this physique, but this is temporary. The moment we have been buried in our burial, like when the moment we enter into the graveyard, like into the grave, 2-3 days later, if we have to exhume the grave again, according to some, they say that you will not even dare to go to that particular graveyard again. Because of the stench which this body is going to give out, the moment we are buried, you cannot bear it anymore. You will not even dare go to that graveyard. So this is the fact about this body. So he says, أَقْبِلْ عَلَى الرُّوحِ فَاسْتَكْمِلْ فَضَائِلَهَا. He says, you better focus more on your ruh, more on your spirit, on your soul, on your mind, rather than you saying so much of concern regarding your appearance. فَأَنْتَ بِالنَّفْسِ لَا بِالْجِسْمِ إِنْسَانُ. Because you consider to be a human being only by your moral and your good conduct, but not by your physique. For an example, if you're driving your car, and all of a sudden you see somebody jump in the road, from nowhere he came in front of you, what would be your impression? What are the words you're going to tell him?
Are you going to call him, "Oh human being, why did you do this?" You're not going to speak to him in that fashion. You're going to use some other word. Sometimes you will attribute him to an animal, because this is not suitable for you to do. He might be wearing the most expensive clothes, but the moment he does it, you will say you're worse than an animal. So the character, the moral, the way you conduct matters a lot than your appearance. So brothers and elders in Islam, so let us see how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam imprinted his image to an outsider. The riwayat is in Bukhari. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions were on a journey. So when they were on their way, they were feeling very tired and they wanted to take a rest. So they wanted to spend their night in a place. So all of them slept and they were really tired. The sleep had overtaken them and they slept for a very long time. It is mentioned it was almost sunrise. It is almost sunrise. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar radiallahu anhu were the first to wake up. So they woke up and they went to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they said, "Ya Rasulullah, it's time for salah, we have to pray Fajr." So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam woke up and they used some water, and once they had finished the ablution and stuff, they didn't have enough water. So when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was about to conduct the prayer, he sees a person who was seated in a corner, who was one of his companions. He said to him, "What made you sit there? Why don't you come join the congregation?" He said, "Ya Rasulullah, I had experienced a wet dream last night, so I have to perform a farz bath. I have to take a compulsory bath, ghusl." So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Okay, we don't have water, so you better take tayammum and join the jama'ah." So he performs tayammum and they pray for the Salatul Fajr. So once they completed the prayer, they continued the journey. So while they continued the journey, the Sahaba started to feel the thirst. The sun was out, it was almost noon, and they couldn't resist it anymore, they couldn't bear it anymore. So they said, "Ya Rasulullah, we need water." So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Imran ibn Husayn radiallahu anhu and a few other Sahaba to fetch some water, to find out anybody has some water in that particular place. So when these Sahabas were going, they came across a very old aged lady. She was coming in her camel. She had two water sacks with her. So the Sahabas asked her, "Could you please tell us how far do we need to travel to fetch some water? Because we have got a group with us." She said, "If you are to travel now, you are going to reach that place after 24 hours. So it's going to take you one day for you to reach the place where you can fetch water. So water is at such a distance." So they said, "Why don't you help us by giving us some water?" She said, "No, I have undergone so much of difficulty and you are asking for water." Then the Sahaba said, "Okay, it's alright. Why don't you come and meet our leader? Why don't you meet him?" So this lady agreed. She came and she met Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, "Why don't you help us by giving your water?" She gave the same reply and she said, "You know, I am a very old aged woman and I have got orphans at home. I have to feed them as well. So I am running out of time. I have to reach home." So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "It is all right, but just give me the water sack which you have." So the moment it was given to him, due to the karamat of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the will of Allah, he said Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim and he wiped over the water sack. And afterwards, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Sahaba to bring the utensils so that they can fill and store the water in them, so that they could travel peacefully. So they filled their utensils, all of them quenched their thirst. Imran ibn Husayn radiallahu anhu says, there were 40 in number. So they quenched their thirst, they filled their utensils, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to his Sahaba, "You better give in return, be grateful to this lady, give this and give her some roti." So this was given to her and she was amazed by this akhlaq. Because this was the first time She had met this person. This was the first time she encountered Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So moment she saw this akhlaq of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was shocked. And so she returned to her family and she told her family regarding whatever happened. She said, you know, I came across this man. I don't know whether he's a sorcerer or is he a magician, or some of them even call him a prophet. But this man, the way he intermingled with me, the way he interacted with me, had caught my heart, and he's a very kind person. And it is mentioned, after a few days or a few months, the whole family accepted Islam. So brothers and elders in Islam, we see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way he imprinted his impression on those who were outsiders was great, and it was that even they accepted Islam wholeheartedly. And it is mentioned, the first meeting of a person would imprint 70% of a person on a person's mind. So 70% of a person is understood and recognized by the first time you meet him. So therefore, one should treat a person as if it is the first and last time you are going to meet him. If we are asked to treat a person, we have to treat him in such a way as, this is the first time I am meeting you and this is the last time I am going to meet you. I am not going to meet you again in my life. Imagine how I am going to treat that person. If a sheikh comes from a foreign country, if a very renowned scholar comes, we warmly welcome him, we treat him very well, very nicely. Why is that? Because we don't know whether we will be able to welcome him again. Likewise, brothers and elders in Islam, we have to welcome, we have to treat each and every Muslim or non-Muslim with this akhlaq of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So remember, whenever we say first impression is the last impression, remember this incident of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is the first one out of the four I wanted to share. And number two is with regard to youngsters. How do we move with youngsters, the young children? Most of us, all of us, we remember our school days. Some of us regret, won't those days come back again? Because we used to enjoy so much. We didn't have any responsibility. We didn't even bother about our lunch, our breakfast. We did not earn. We did not even, A to Z, we are sponsored by our parents. Even the ticket you're going to take in the bus, is sponsored. A to Z is sponsored. The moment you turn 18 and 19, 20, the moment you hit that age, now you start thinking about your expense, you start thinking about the fuel you're going to pump into your vehicle, into your bicycle, and you start thinking about so many things. So you start thinking, well, won't those beautiful days come again? Because we used to live, we had a heart which was free from any disturbance, without any difficulty. So during those school days, we remember many happy incidents. We remember many happy incidents. The day we were given a certificate. The day a teacher, she commented on us in a very good way, in front of the whole school. The day the teacher told that, you know, this student has finished his homework and he's, mashallah, a very hard-working student. The day your parents met the teacher says, mashallah, I don't have a single complaint about this boy. So you feel happy. We recall those days even today. Likewise, brothers and elders in Islam, we have bitter moments as well. We have moments when we hated so many friends of ours. A friend of mine, we used to pray that he doesn't come to school. Because the moment he comes into school, he is the destroyer of all pleasures. You see, bullies in every school. So likewise, when we have one in class, he is the biggest threat. So we have bad moments with them, and we don't forget those as well. We don't forget the day the principal called us and he reprimanded us. He has given us some beating, used the cane. We don't forget those incidents as well. So when we take a very young child who is less than 5 or who is studying at the nursery, you see the teachers are very friendly with them. They are very friendly with them. Sometimes They will do things which are naughty, but some of them enjoy. Most of us enjoy what the children do. But sometimes, when we are not in a good mood, it really disturbs us. But when it comes to a teacher in a Montessori school, she has to undergo all these difficulties. She has to have patience. And due to her patience, and because of her good akhlaq with that child, end of the day, what does she receive? She gets a call from the parent saying, "Thank you very much. We have taught my child so many good habits, and he or she is practicing them at home. And this teacher feels very happy because it is the product of her." So brothers and elders in Islam, this student, this teacher, wanted to capture the heart of this young child. Likewise, it is not only the teacher who is responsible to capture the heart of that child. Each one of us, each and every human being on the face of this earth, should know the mechanism, should know the method of capturing the heart of that young child. You see, at times, our little ones at home, they would come to us on the day of the festival wearing a very nice cloth, and you wearing one of the very beautiful ones, and you expect somebody to come and tell you, "You look really handsome with this." So the moment somebody praises you like that, you feel, "MashaAllah, it's worth I wearing this." So that same expectation is in that child. So that child comes in front of you and shows, "Oh, maybe you are an uncle," starts showing, and you say, "Oh, MashaAllah, you look nice." And you are busy with your laptop or your mobile phone. So this child thinks, this human being is like, he hasn't got a sense of humor in him. He's very hard. Again, it comes from the right side, says, "Uncle, do I look nice?" You say, "Yeah." Comes from the left, "Yeah." It comes from front, you say, "I have told you, you look nice, please don't disturb me." That is the general approach of most of the people. But when it comes to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a man who used to recognize the feelings of those young children. He used to say, you look really handsome, you look really attractive with this cloth, with this dress. This was the akhlaq of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was a sahabi who was very young, and he had a bird, he had a pet with him, and the name of the pet was Nughayb, and the sahabi's name was Umayr. So whenever Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and for some days Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam observed that Umayr radiallahu anhu was not comfortable, he was in a very upset mood. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam met him and he said, "Ya Umayr, ma fa'ala Nughayr?" "Oh Umayr, what has Nughayr done to you?" He was a very young boy, around 6 to 7 years. The Prophet who went to the skies and he undertook the journey of Mi'raj and he brought Salat to us. The Prophet who spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet who received direct revelation from Allah, if he had this akhlaq in him, subhanallah, he was a man who was thinking about his nation. He thought about each and every person during that time. Why aren't the people following the correct path? But in spite of all that, he had time which he used to spend with the young ones as well. So let me give you a story of what happened to one of the famous sheikhs. He said, he had gone to a school. This is how you win hearts of youngsters. It's very important. When it comes to youth, they expect some tips. When a person is, you know, he wants to look attractive, he starts to apply all sorts of creams and, you know, he wants to look handsome. So the moment you approach this young boy and you tell him, "Why do you apply all this?" He says, "No, I want to look attractive, you know, amongst my, you know, my friends, and, you know, people start praising me." The moment you tell him, "You know, I will give you some other prescription. In the long run, it is going to be very beneficial to you." He said, "Yes, yes, I want that tip. What's that tip? Give me some tips for this." You say, "You better perform your salat on time, and you better perform salatul tahajjud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will illuminate your face." The moment you tell that, say, "Is it true?" Say, "Yes, it is. It is the fact." Says, "Okay, from today onwards, I'm going to be in the masjid. I'll pray on time so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will illuminate my face." So youngsters like a lot of tips. But very young children, they like to be appreciated. They like to be praised. So the Shaykh he says, he went to a school and he posed a question to the crowd. So this very young student, he said, give me a hadith regarding salah. So one of the students said, Shaykh, I know a hadith. The Shaykh said, yes, you're welcome, you can continue. He said, Shaykh, the hadith Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the difference between a mu'min and a kafir is salah. If you want to differentiate between a mu'min and a kafir, it is with salah. The moment the Shaykh heard this hadith, he was overtaken. He couldn't imagine that such a young student has quoted this hadith to him. So as a gift, immediately he removed his watch and gave it as a gift. So the Shaykh mentioned, he says, I didn't bother much about the value of the watch, but it was a reflex action of mine. I wanted to give something to the student and I gave it to him. But what was the turning point? The turning point was, after many years had passed, the Shaykh goes to a masjid to perform his salah. He goes to perform his salah and he sees a very young boy, and this boy approaching him. He says, Shaykh, assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum. Shaykh, wa alaikum assalam. And he was shocked. Why does a person whom I don't know want to greet me like this? He said, yeah, what's the matter? He said, Shaykh, do you remember a day when you came to my school and you gave me a watch? Then the Shaykh started to recall and he said, yes, I do remember that. He said, the student whom you gave that watch, it was me. The day you gave me the watch, it really inspired me and I wanted to become a person like you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made me such, and now I have become a khatib in a masjid and I am following a course regarding the qudat. I want to become a qadi in my future. Subhanallah. A watch, just because of one hadith, opened the way for that young boy that he became an alim and he was becoming a master in passing judgment. Allahu Akbar. So brothers and elders in Islam, with children we have to be very kind and gentle. We have to listen to their stories. We have to listen to their stories. Sometimes girls will start speaking, you cannot stop them compared to boys. If you ask them what happened in school, they can mention all those incidents which took place on that day, and you start feeling, you know, it's enough. Okay, stop. The moment you say stop, they feel bad. So anybody, any young child, a very young boy, he comes to you and he wants to share some experience, just listen to him. Maybe by you listening to him, you are capturing his heart. That was how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to interact with the children. For an example, when it comes to practice in our community and many parts in the world, when a person enters into a gathering with his child, with his son, normally, if the father is a very famous person, or most of us will be giving importance to greet the father. You handshake and say, how are you? You know, you ask so many questions. But if you see the son is following the father, the son is not given the same salam. The moment the father came, assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, smiles on the face, and the son comes, assalamu alaikum, and son leaves. So the son doesn't feel that he's special. So what we need to do is, brothers, the moment we see somebody enter like that, we have to make that boy feel that you are special. Just as your father, we greet you the same. We don't have any, we don't give importance to him and we neglect you. No, we don't ignore anybody. We treat all the same. So we greet the father in the same manner. We greet the child also in the same manner. So that the child will feel that I am special. So let me quote an incident of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with regard to this. Anas radiallahu anhu, he was 10 years old when he started to do khidmat to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to serve the Prophet. So he was a very smart and a very mischievous child. So all of us know, when a person is about to reach his teenage, he enjoys playing, he enjoys being with friends, he doesn't like to be secluded. He doesn't like that. So Anas radiallahu anhu was a person, he was a boy like that. So he said, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to send me out to buy some stuff from the market. So one day, I was given the responsibility to bring some stuff. While on my way, I saw some of my friends playing. some of my friends, they were playing. The moment I saw them play, I couldn't bear it. Like, I was forced to go join them. So I forgot about the responsibility which was given to me by the Prophet, and I went there and I started to play with them. After some time, I forgot what to buy. I have forgotten what to buy. He said, I came back to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I was very shy and I was fearing what would be the response of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Anas radiallahu anhu came inside his house, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what should Anas do? What should Anas do? He has nothing in his hand. I had sent him to buy something. He hasn't got anything in his hand. He has forgotten what to buy. And Allah makes him forget to do everything. So you see the way Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam interacted with that young boy. In another instance, we see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him, and Anas radiallahu anhu spoke, like, he told himself that I'm not going to play with anybody today, even if my friends call me. So he was very firm. But the moment he saw them play, as a young boy, he again went into the group and he started to play. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was waiting outside. So where is this young boy? He didn't return. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went out to find this boy. The moment he went out, he sees Anas radiallahu anhu with his friends. The moment Anas radiallahu anhu saw Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was shocked and he was scared. He didn't know what is going to happen next. Because of his carelessness, he's going to fall into trouble again. So what did he do? He came to the Prophet and he stood by him and he told, I have lost the money as well. I didn't buy anything and I have lost the money you gave me, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I was just about to go there. The Anas radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, I just wanted to go. I wanted to leave now to buy your stuff. I was just playing. Just prior to your coming, I wanted to go. But you came before I went. That is why I couldn't bring you the stuff. This is how he wanted to manage Nabi. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't reprimand him nor scold him. He just smiled at him because he knew that he was a very young boy. Subhanallah. This was how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's character was with young children. There are so many instances mentioned. The way he used to interact with the youth, it is mentioned that he used to ask the youngsters to wrestle. He would ask them to wrestle and he would ask them prove who is strong. He would ask the youngsters to shoot arrows. He used to train them archery and he would say, let's see who can do it well. So brothers and elders in Islam, this is how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's interaction was with children. And when it comes to the poor, when it comes to the poor people, they are the ones who have been, like, most of the people don't bother to give them any importance, or we don't hold them high in the community. So sometimes when a very poor man is to crack a joke with us, sometimes in certain gatherings, if a poor man is to crack a joke, nobody bothers to laugh. Because he is announced, like, he is not from the group, so it is a joke which is just for a moment. But when a wealthy person, a rich man, is to crack a joke, that is considered to be a joke, and people start to share it, and they start to speak about it, and then they start to laugh. So, let me give you an incident where Zahir ibn Haram radiallahu anhu, he used to live in the outskirts of Medina. Out of Medina, he was in the village, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from Medina, in the city. So, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, Zahir, he is our contact in the village and we are his contact in the city. So whenever Zahir radiallahu anhu used to come to Medina to sell his stuff, he would meet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before he goes to the marketplace. So one day Zahir radiallahu anhu comes to Medina and he doesn't see Prophet in the masjid. He doesn't find him. So he thought, okay, let me go to the bazaar and let me do my transactions and let me meet Nabi later on. So he goes to the marketplace and he starts to sell his stuff. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed that Zahir has come to meet him. He is in the city. So we see the humbleness of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, where is Zahir? And he starts to search Zahir in the markets of Medina. Finally he sees Zahir radiallahu anhu. He's selling his stuff in the pavement. So brothers and elders in Islam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes to Zahir radiallahu anhu and he covers his eyes from behind. So Zahir radiallahu anhu did not know who this person was. So he tried to get away, but Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was hugging him. So the moment Zahir radiallahu anhu recognized and understood that it was Nabi, he leant his back against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's chest. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started to make an announcement. May yashtari hadha al-abd? Who is going to buy this slave? Who is going to buy this slave? It is mentioned regarding the description of this Sahabi. He was a dark, he was a black, unattractive Sahabi. And he was not at that moment when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to meet him, he wasn't smelling good because he was in the hot sun. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to that Sahabi, maybe in the eyes of the people, the Sahabi said, Ya Rasulullah, you want to sell me? If you want to sell me, I'm going to be very cheap because I don't have anything with me, Ya Rasulullah. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consoled the Sahabi. He said, maybe in the eyes of the people you are very cheap, but in the eyes of Allah, you are a very expensive human being. So this was how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam interacted with the poor. When you take those who are poor, who cannot afford, they never accuse the rich because of their miserliness. Most of the poor people, they don't accuse the rich because the rich are miser. But they accuse the rich regarding their attitude, regarding the way they interact with the poor. At some gatherings, sometimes even in janaza, when you go to a house where there is a janaza or a wedding feast or a walima, most of the time we like to sit with those who are in alim. The poor are in a corner, they are seated alone, nobody to speak to them, nobody bothers about them. They come, they have the meal and they just leave the place. They are not spoken about, nobody wants to speak to them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects us to deal with the poor. We see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the dua, Ya Allah, make me live as a miskin. Allahumma ahini miskinan. Ya Allah, make me live as a miskin. Ya Allah, make me die as a miskin. Ya Allah, resurrect me amongst the group of the masakin. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved the masakin. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, what type of treatment can we do to the poor of today? Maybe a smile which you're going to have in your face, you're smiling at him, you make him feel that he's special. We like somebody to smile at us. The moment you smile at somebody and he frowns at you, how do you feel? You feel very bad. But the moment you see a person initiates a smile, you are comfortable to continue it. But there are some people whom, if we are to pay them money, if you ask them, I'm ready to pay you so much, can you please smile? Even then they are not prepared to smile. Brothers and elders in Islam, it's a very easy amal. You smile at a poor man. Maybe we go to a supermarket, we go to the masjid, where that person who keeps the slippers and these bags and stuff, he's a man who is not even bothered to be looked at. Nobody bothers to sit with him and speak to him. There are so many people amongst us. If we intermingle with them, there will be a man closer to our house. He has a very small tuck shop, a very poor man who sells a few stuff. If we can greet him, if we can smile at him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes will make that as a means for our daraja to increase in this world and the hereafter. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, maybe he is a Muslim or not, but to win the heart of that poor man, to win that man who is put aside in the society, you make him feel, no, you are not put aside, you are also with us. That is going to make him feel really special. And finally, respected brothers and elders in Islam, the manner in which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam interacted with the enemies of his, with his enemies. A famous, one of the traitors of Islam was Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul was the leader of the munafiqs. He said, with regard to him, he has betrayed Islam, he has betrayed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in so many instances. He plotted against Islam. The reason for him to become the leader of the Munafiqs was prior to the migration of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Medina, he was the person whom the people wanted him to be a leader. So the probability of him becoming a leader in Medina was far more greater than his opponents. So the moment this was the case, all of a sudden an outsider, a foreigner from Makkah, comes into Medina. So when Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul sees this, he sees that people are starting to follow this new message, new religion. And he sees that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has conquered the hearts of many. And now people insisted that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should become the leader of Medina and not Ubay ibn Salul. Ubay ibn Salul thought, this Muhammad who just came from nowhere, who is not natively from Medina, how come he become a leader? So he, from that day onwards, he plotted and planned against Islam. So the first step he did, he accepted Islam openly, but instead he used to hide his hypocrisy and he used to plot against Islam. In the Battle of Uhud, this hypocrite, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he joined the army of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And halfway through, he says, we don't want to continue with you. And he returned back with 300 soldiers. In one of the battles, he says, if we are to return back to Medina after the battle, we are going to expel the foreigners who came into our city. So he met the Quraysh, the Muhajir, who had migrated. He said, after this battle, when we get back to Medina, we are going to expel these people, so that we can rule the place. But even though he used to speak these words out, apparently he used to be in the masjid, he used to perform his salat, but he was the leader of all the munafiqs. But that was one instance. The second instance was, respected brothers and elders in Islam, he accused Aisha radiallahu anha that she committed zina. Such an enemy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he passed away, and his son Abdullah comes to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, Ya Rasulullah, can you give me your qamis, your shirt, so that I can shroud my father? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not hesitate. He said, here it is, and he removed the shirt and he gave it to this hypocrite son. His son was a practicing Muslim, he was a perfect Muslim. So the Sahabas were like shocked. Why, Ya Rasulullah, why have you got to give your shirt to a man who was plotting against Islam? Respected brothers and elders in Islam, you see, he was an enemy of this noble deed. But why did Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give it? The ulama have written many reasons, but out of the many reasons, one of the most accepted reason is, the moment on the battle of Badr, Abbas radiallahu anhu, who participated in the battle, he was in the Quraysh, the Kafir side. So when he was taken as a captive, Abbas radiallahu anhu did not have any clothes to wear. This Abbas radiallahu anhu was an uncle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Nabi was waiting for somebody to come forward to give his uncle a shirt to cover himself. So when they tried out the clothes which they found, they saw only Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul's shirt was fitting Abbas radiallahu anhu. So at that moment, this hypocrite was prepared to give away his shirt for the uncle of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a gratitude to that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give his shirt to him the day he died, and kafan was made to this munafiq using the shirt of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the akhlaq of Nabi when it came to the way he interacted with his enemies. So brothers and elders in Islam, when we take his life, he has covered, as I mentioned previously, all aspects in life. He has not left a single place where we can point a finger at him and find a fault. If a person is rich, he could follow the footsteps of Nabi. Remember the days when he used to take the trade caravans to Sham. Then if you are a rich person, you could follow his trades at that time. If you are a poor man, you could follow him, follow the footsteps of Nabi. The day he was migrating to Medina, he didn't have a single cent with him. So as a poor man, he migrated to Medina. He established himself in Medina as a poor man. So you have, we have teachings through that as well. If a person is a king, he could follow his sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet was a king who won the hearts of millions of people. Millions of people, brothers and elders in Islam. Within a period of 23 years, he had so many followers who were ready to give their lives for him. If you are a weak man, think about the example when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very weak in the initial stages of da'wah. If a person is a conqueror, he too has teachings. Remember the day of Badr. As a conqueror, how did Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam conduct himself? If you are a teacher, you have guidance in him. Remember the days when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to teach his companion. If you are a student, you have teaching. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a student of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. If you are an advisor, remember the times when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to advise the people in the Medina masjid. If you are an orphan, remember that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father had passed away before his birth, and Nabi sallallahu his mother had passed away while he was a child. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, in short, in today's lecture, we have been speaking on the matters and qualities of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we have to see that we have to bring as much as possible of all these things into practice. Let me summarize what we have spoken. First, we started speaking about importance of listening and having a proper intention before listening to a sermon. So at least we at least pick and choose minimum one teaching of whatever was said today, and thereafter we spoke about what the Quran speaks when it comes to listening, and then about Prophet's life and what the non-Muslims used to say about him, and about the knowledge we have regarding Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also following the Prophet, the ayahs of the Quran which was mentioned in the Quran, which was mentioned regarding following of the Prophet, and regarding the Sahaba, how they used to adhere to the Sunnah of Nabi when it came to certain instances. Example, I quoted the instance of alcohol, and finally we discussed about four instances. One is the way he impressed people the moment he met them for the first time. And number two, the way he interacted with children, the way he interacted with the poor, and the way he interacted with his enemies, and especially with the hypocrites of the Muslims. So we have to bring about a change. Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah is not going to bring about a change in a nation until they themselves bring a change about. So we have to initiate a change in ourselves after each and every lecture so that it will be useful. And as I told you, I would encourage you to read a few books related to the seerah of Nabi. You want to learn further? The Sealed Nectar, written by Sheikh Mubarak Puri, which was awarded as well, Rahiful Maktub, an Arabic book which is translated into English, is available in the market. The Sealed Nectar, a very famous book, a bestseller as well. And the second book I would like to encourage you to read is Enjoy Your Life, Enjoy Your Life of Sheikh Arifi. And number three is A Mercy to the Universe, A Mercy to the Universe. You will really enjoy, you will know that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a leader who used to practice what he used to preach. He wasn't a leader, he wasn't a boss who used to boss the people, but he was a leader who used to intermingle with his people, with his nation. And he left such a legacy which cannot be produced or which cannot be brought to this face of this earth again by any individual to come. So we ask Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He opens our hearts to what is correct and make us amongst those who would follow the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that we can be in His companionship in paradise. And also may Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all sorts of innovations and all sorts of sins and evils. With those few words, Jazakumullahu khairan for giving me this opportunity to address the youngsters here. So may Almighty Allah accept this gathering. Wa akhir da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.